In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
Good morning.
We are so glad that you came today. This is a place where we hope you find healing, learning, belonging. All of you who have come here this morning with a burden on your shoulders, you feel wounded. All of you who say, I shouldn't be at church this morning, my horns got caught on the door. We say to you, you are family. We love you just as you are. Even if your girlfriend dragged you to church today, no matter who you are, we just want to say we love you. We're so, so glad that you're here. And would you show that love to your neighbor now by turning around, shaking their hand, and greeting them warmly in the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We trust you today as we draw closer to Christmas. We are journeying through the darkness, just as many characters journeyed through the darkness to find Jesus. And we keep you, God, before our mind. We want to see Jesus glorified in the midst of our darkness. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah as we prepare for the morning message. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, branches will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash of his waist. The wolf will lie down with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
Mary, did you know your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again.
As 2015 comes to a close, I want to say thank you to each and every one of you who regularly support this program. Your prayers and gifts have meant the world to us, and we just can't say thank you enough. This year, your generous support helped us expand this program into new television markets, reaching more people who need to hear the positive message of Jesus Christ. And as we move into 2016, we'll add even more outlets for people to hear about God's love for them. Now, as we close out the year, we're excited to offer you a deluxe Hour of Power edition of my newest book, Happiness According to Jesus. It's a book about how the Sermon on the Mount and the wisdom of Jesus is what brings us into the full, rich life that we all desperately want. I'm so passionate about this book that when you request your copy, I'll personally sign it for you. Or even taking it a step further, when you give us your request for this book, include a prayer request or a specific moment when you felt happy or blessed, and your book will include a Bible verse selected just for you by the Hour of Power staff. You know, we receive letters, phone calls, and emails every day from people who are finding hope, rebuilding their families, or overcoming addiction or depression. Whether you're Janet from Denver or Mike from Sacramento, we want to hear from you. We want to pray for you, and we want to help you in your faith walk. Friends, thank you for supporting this program. Your gifts, prayers, and words of encouragement mean the world, and we couldn't do it without you. Thank you, and remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
As a thank you for your year-end support, we're pleased to offer a deluxe Hour of Power edition of Pastor Bobby's newest book, Happiness According to Jesus. We are offering the deluxe book for your tax-deductible donation of $60. This includes the book and a personally inscribed autograph by Pastor Bobby. So call, write, or go online and request your copy today. For your gift of $100, we'll not only send you Pastor Bobby's autographed book, Happiness According to Jesus, we'll also include a set of two beautifully designed porcelain mugs, each imprinted with an inspiring quote from the book. Do good. Bless others. And prayer is letting go. Your gifts help the Hour of Power stay on the air and make a positive difference to viewers around the world. We can't do it without you, so please write, call, or go online with your gift today.
Great job, Richard. Give him a hand. What an awesome guy, huh? Thank you, Richard, for all you do for us. We love you. I am thrilled to welcome back to our church today as our guest, J. Marc McVey. He's best known for his theater credits. Marc is a Helen Hayes winning actor with more than 3,200 performances in the role of Jean Valjean in the world's most famous musical, Les Miserables. He was the tenor of choice of the late maestro Marvin Hamlisch and continues to perform with the greatest symphonies around the world. He has 3 solo CDs, a gold record collaboration, but most importantly, he is a faithful follower of Jesus Christ and is here to testify to that. So, J. Marc McVey, we're so glad you're here. Thanks. Good morning. Some people here may not know how important the things that I read, but those things that I've just said are huge in the theater world, and the accomplishments in your career is so impressive. And I think one of the things that's so impressive to me, first of all, is how you can be this successful in theater and also have such an, I mean, even talking to you backstage, just an avid love and faith for Jesus Christ. Now, you're from West Virginia.
Yes, I am. Thank you so much, Pastor. It's a joy. I think the joy comes from the Father and, you know, being able to use the gifts that you were given and to have accomplished these wonderful things in life is great. But the greatest joy, I think, is to know where your gifts come from and be able to deliver them, knowing that they will reach the ears they're supposed to reach, that the messages will impact those that are supposed to be impacted without even really doing anything except using the gifts you were given.
Yeah.
And that's a true joy.
And of course, you chased your dream. I mean, coming from West Virginia, you came, I don't know, I presume you came to LA or wherever, and you traveled the world doing these incredible performances.
I did. I wanted to be a Broadway singer from a very young age. I can remember in kindergarten, our day would start with the Lord's Prayer, the Pledge of Allegiance, and then the singing of the state song. And every single day, the state song would end up with me standing on a chair singing. And so I knew pretty early on what I was going to do the rest of my life, or what I wanted to do. And I was just very, very blessed that God, you know, gifted me that way. And my parents were incredible supporters that way. We were raised in a church. I was raised in a Methodist church in Huntington, West Virginia. And, you know, what they say about Methodists is that they're not always the best singers, but they're always the loudest. So I learned an awful lot about music under some wonderful teachers there at the church. And my mother had a professional quality voice. She sang on Christian radio from age 15. She was a singer. And so honestly, we came by our gifts. And it's a joy. It's a joy.
You're an artist, but you're not a Christian artist in the sense of a Christian label. Is it difficult being sort of an outspoken Christian, but also being so successful in the mainline theater world? Is that a challenge for you? Or
it is. I think you really have to be careful of where you are an outspoken Christian. And that makes me sad, quite actually. It makes me very sad. But God puts us in certain places to use us for certain things. And so he wants me to be the best example that I can be of his love and grace, you know, wherever it is that he puts me. And I have actually been using lately, though, much more using the platform as a quote unquote calling card ministry, if you will, to try to bring folks into the doors of churches that may not step inside the church for any other reason, but they hear that there's going to be a Broadway singer coming to sing. And when they get there, we kind of pull the, you know, bait and switch on them a little bit, because I'm obviously very, very proud of my heritage in Christ, and so they get a little bit of that anyway. I talk about the characters that I'm maybe singing the song from, and how that character related to me, or how I can relate to that character, but then also try to tell something about the story, the message that that character is delivering, and put that through Christ's eyes as well, to see if maybe we can't get someone reached for the Lord.
Yeah, I always feel like preaching the gospel ought to be more subtle than the way a lot of people do it. I mean, I think that the first thing that you preach the gospel should be our lifestyle, the way that we treat others, and the love that we have and grace that we show towards others. I think that one of the greatest examples you could set in the theater, for example, is when everybody else is upset and you're calm and you're collected and you know, happy, and people wonder what's different. Those are the types of things that I think should set Christians apart, is their behavior, their love. And I think too often people feel like, well, I got to go in there and change it and shove religion down people's throat. But what I hear you saying is that it's much more subtle, that you want it to be, you want people to come to you, and you want to set the example through your love.
It is. I agree with you 100%. I think that's absolutely the way. And it's not as easy.
Yeah.
It's really not. You want to profess your love for Christ, and more than that, you want to profess His love for you.
Yeah,
And so
you have millions of people listening around the world. What is the one thing you've learned this far in your life that you would love to share with everyone listening?
Wow. I think it would be that you, just to have everyone know that God loves them dearly, that each and every single person on the face of this earth is a precious, precious, dear gem to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and to God the Father. I think it's also important to know that the brain works in very strange ways. So you have to kind of control that brain. If you think about negative things all the time, you will get negative results. If you think about positive things, the good things that happen to you, and hang on to those victories that you have, you will have positive things happen to you. The results will be positive. And the good Lord wants absolutely nothing more. He is the most positive influence ever known. And His love is just there for you.
Well, Marc, we certainly do believe that, and we are ones who believe in the love of God and the positive message, and so we're so glad that you came here to remind us of that. And today you're going to sing for us, Bring Him Home from Les Miserables.
I am.
Thank you for coming today, Marc. We love you. God bless you.
Love you, too.
This song is from the second act, Barricade. This character, Jean Valjean, that I've been so very, very blessed to be able to perform, really shaped my life. Being able to deliver the message of grace all over the world more than 3,200 times, and every night, night after night after night, is a true, true blessing. And I hope that this song blesses you all in this wonderful season. I love you. God loves you. Bring him peace.
you, Mark McVey. Thank you, brother. Thank you, can brother. You can get his CDs, too, online. And will you be here afterwards signing?
I will. I'm going to go out and say hi to folks. I hope they'll stop by the table and say hi. And you can get them online, jmarkmcvey.com.
All right.
It.
Thank you, brother. We appreciate
you, brother.
It. Thank you for coming today.
God
bless you.
God bless
Give
you.
Him another hand. Good morning, everyone. I just want to say you picked a good day to come to church. It's always a good day to come to church. So says the pastor, right? Okay. I hope your Christmas isn't getting too crazy. We are in the season now when all of the bad things about our culture somehow love to emerge to the surface. Many of us during this season are feeling hurried. We're feeling angry. We're feeling rushed. Some of us are worried about that Christmas day when we're going to have to sit down with a family member that we frankly don't want to see. And this should not be what Advent is. Advent is the season of waiting and preparing our hearts for Christmas. And that's the idea that we're going to be focusing on today is hope. And as we talk about Advent, I want us to be thinking about the characters from the Christmas story. Think about in reality how dark and difficult the Christmas story really is. I mean, you think of some of the characters, the Magi traveling years from the east, following a star, dangerous roads to find the new Messiah. Shepherds out in the hills, cold, traveling to see the new Messiah. And especially Joseph and Mary, you know. Mary was a 15-year-old Jewish Middle Eastern girl having her first baby. And nobody, it's cold. Nobody will let her in anywhere because all the hotels are filled. And so she gets to go into literally a barn and put her baby in a feeding trough. And that's tough. So Advent, the word Advent means the arrival or the coming of the Messiah. And it's really the coming of a promise. And so the season of Advent, and I'll be saying this every week, is a season for all of us who are journeying through sort of the dark night of the soul, going through difficult times in life. Advent is a season of prayer and waiting that the Christ child would be born in the midst of our darkness. And so many of us are like pilgrims walking a dangerous, dark road to find Jesus. And so the theme that I want us to focus on is keeping Christ before our minds as we travel. As we travel on this road of life, keeping Christ before our minds, that will set things right. And today we will say we keep Christ before our minds so that we can have hope. Hope. Pandora's box is a famous metaphor. It goes something like this. Prometheus steals fire from heaven. He's a god, and he brings this fire to mankind, and this becomes this great gift for human beings. Some people say, oh, it's the beginning of, the myth says it's the beginning of technology. And Zeus becomes so angry at Prometheus that he decides he's going to get him back. And how's he going to get him back? Well, he takes this jar, we'll call it a box. He takes this box, and in this box, he puts all of the evils and terrible things of the world. And he seals the box, and he gives it to a beautiful woman named Pandora. And he tells Pandora, I'm going to give you to Prometheus's brother. And sure enough, Prometheus, his brother, receives Pandora, and Pandora is given specific instructions. Do not open this box. And of course, because she's curious, she opens the box, and all of this evil and all of these terrible things start pouring out into the world. And Pandora, in a panic, tries to close the box, tries to seal it, and she can't get it closed until it's completely empty, except for one thing. And the myth says that she looks, and there at the bottom, hope remained. And that was when hope was born. And the idea is simply this. Pandora then releases hope into the world that the only way that we as human beings with our technology and all of our willpower and all the ways that we try and work hard, the only way that we really overcome evil in the long run is hope. Hope is that one unique thing that makes us human. It's the thing that that gives us the strength and the power that against all odds, when you're against the ropes, when you're at the end of the line, you still believe, even though there's nothing, no rational reason to believe, you still just believe that you can make it, that you can get through, that you're going to live or that you're going to overcome. You don't know how, you don't know how it's going to happen, but you have this thing in your guts called hope that says no matter how hard or how bad things get, I won't give up because somehow I've just learned that there's a reason to hang on and somehow I will get through this. And that is what hope is. The passage that was read today was a passage about the hope of Israel. It's from the prophecy of Isaiah, and it talks about the stump, Jesse's stump. Imagine you see this stump, a gigantic stump, and it's cut, and it's something dead. You imagine how big this tree used to be. You think, man, it went way into the sky, and have these huge branches, and you just, all you see now is a stump and this massive root system, and you think what used to be so alive and so awesome is now dead. And then you look closely and you see that there is a green shoot coming from the top of the stump, and that's what Isaiah says he sees. He says, from Jesse's stump is coming a green shoot, and this will be my servant. And he will be filled with the Spirit of the Lord, which is the Spirit of wisdom and counsel and might and knowledge. And he's going to set things right in the world. Everything will be set right by this one that God is sending. And this is the hope that Israel had for years and years. This idea that someday the Messiah was going to come and rescue everyone. This hope that even in exile in Babylon, someday God's going to rescue us with a Messiah from Jesse's stump. And someday that little green shoot will turn into an even bigger, better tree that will bear tremendous fruit. And we can praise God that green shoot did come, and his name is Jesus. And that's what Paul believed. In Romans, Paul then cites this passage. He cites it from the Septuagint, which is a Greek version of the Hebrew Bible. He says, the root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him, the Gentiles will hope. And then Paul says this to his people. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The idea that the same Holy Spirit that was in Jesus, that spirit of wisdom and counsel, might, knowledge, that belief that I could overcome anything on God's side, is now within you. Your life, because of the Holy Spirit, should overflow with hope as you live life in partnership with Jesus. This spirit of Jesus that lives in you is most often referred to in the Bible as the Comforter. And I think the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter because when you have the Spirit of Christ in you, you never give up. You never lose hope, and you keep hope alive. You can have hope no matter how hard things get, especially this Christmas. You trust a God and live in the reality of a God-bathed world in which God is a giver, not a taker. God is a blesser, not a curser. When God made you and cherishes you and loves you, I said, what about all my sin? Well, that's what the cross is for. What about all the mistakes I make? God loves you. God wants to bless you. He wants you to overcome. You know, this idea of a Jewish God that's presented as God as a giver stands at odds to a God that is a taker in the Mesopotamian world. The Mesopotamians in the ancient Jewish world believed that the gods, the pantheon, were angry lightning throwers and cursers and were just erratic in their behavior and just couldn't wait to destroy humanity, very much like this Zeus figure in the myth. You know, just wanted to curse humanity. But the Jews said, no, we've met God. There's only one of them, and he's pretty cool. He's very warm. We serve a God who loves us, and yes, He wants what is right, but he's a God that wants to redeem the world. He is a God that gives. And so a Jewish Christian God, the God that we serve, is a God that gives. I walked this morning in preparation for today, and I went to Peter's Canyon, and you see birds flying and the sun rising, and as it sun, you know, rises over the mountains, the warmth of the sun comes over me, and I just think, there's waves and waves of God's goodness and gift to me that morning and to you. The music this morning is a gift from God being given through these musicians to you. What goodness God wants to bless you with. And in the Reformed Church, we call these common graces, just the good, wonderful, God just is giving it to you. It's free because he loves you. God has a giving posture. I need one person from the orchestra to come up here, please. All right, Steve Velez. Steve, hi. Hands are important to musicians.
Yes.
Your hands are treasures to you in a way that they're not to many of us. Show me with your right hand, if you were going to do a giving posture with your right hand, what would that look like? If you were giving me something with your right hand, how would your right hand look? I don't know. First thing that comes to mind.
It would come out like this.
An open hand.
Yes.
An open hand like this. An open hand encourages. An open hand loves. An open hand hugs. An open hand is a giving hand. An open hand is a loving hand. God is an open-handed God, a giving God, a God that hugs, a God that encourages. Now show me your hand if you were taking something from me. What would your hand, if just your right hand, if you were going to take something, what would your hand look like? I don't think so. To take something from me. Here's, take this from me. Take it. Huh?
Yeah.
It's a fist.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that make sense? So you have this idea of a Mesopotamian God that takes. Open hand doesn't take, it receives. Does that make sense? So God is a God with an open hand. And God is a God that gives, and therefore God is a God that loves and encourages. But many people think that God's hands are not like this. He thinks his hands like this. He takes, he curses, he attacks, he hates, and that's not the God we serve. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
And that is the posture of God's heart. God has a giving, blessing heart. And that's what Jesus provides us on the cross, a God who gives and nurtures and loves and encourages. That's why you should have hope. And many of us say, well, we see the suffering in the world around us and all of the hurting and all of the difficulty. And yeah, I see that too. That's why it's hope. And how do we reconcile for that? I've talked a lot about the concept of choice and all of these things, but in the end, we live in a physical world that's a spiritual reality, and we have to know that the horrible things that happen in your life and in my life, that God hates those things. But a Christian worldview believes that God wants to use people to overcome. I mean, even Jesus is God using a human being to overcome evil in the world. Too often when we pray, we want to pray and ask that God will just take care of it and that nobody else is involved. We want to overcome, you know, poverty by somehow, you know, systems and just have, instead of just helping poor people ourselves. God wants to use people. And I don't know how to always deal with the tension and with the fog. I don't know how to explain it necessarily, but I do know how to deal with it. And I've always believed that living in this life, in the darkness and the suffering and the struggle when all those hard things happen, is a bit like, imagine you're a captain of a boat and you're feeling a little bit lost in the fog and you don't know where the rocks are and you don't know where the clear water is and you need to get out of this fog right away, and all of a sudden the radio comes on and it's an admiral and he says, I can see you on the GPS. I'm going to guide you out of this thing. You're going to be okay. And so you're just like very thankful. You can't see anything. You don't know how you're going to get out of there, but you're trusting that this guy on the radio can get you out of this thing safely. That's what the Christian life is like in the age that we live. We live in the midst of the fog of not knowing where the rocks are sometimes or all the horrible things that are going to happen. What we trust in God, and we put hope in that so that we keep the boat moving. I remember once when I was going fishing with my dad. We went 2 days out on a cattle rod. It was like $30 or $40. And so we got to get on this gigantic boat with a bunch of other tourists and like stinky-smelling, salty sailors. And my friend and I decided to take a quick trip first to Starbucks. And we got each a venti, I think it's called a red eye. And that's when you fill it with coffee and then you put in two shots of espresso. So we had that. And then when we got to the boat, there was this big hairy guy who was the cook. And he offered us each a double patty bacon cheeseburger. So just after for breakfast at like 5 a.m. So as we've just finished this coffee, of course, we said, yes, we want that burger. We ate the burger and we set sail for some pretty rough seas. Now, we didn't go like along the coast. This was a 2-day journey. And I got sick as a dog, sick as a dog. I don't know if you've ever been seasick before, but you literally want to die. And I remember even thinking at the time, you know, that all of us sort of deal with this fear of death. I remember thinking, you know what, when it's my time to go and I'm afraid, I need to just go get seasick and then I'll die in peace. It's seriously that bad. And I grew up a fisherman, so I wasn't used to being seasick that often, but this was horrible. The only reason I didn't kill myself, and this is like for real, the reason anybody wouldn't kill themselves is why? You know it'll end. You know the land is coming. You know, you don't despair. It's horrible. It's suffering. It's this difficult thing. But you know you're going to get to land, and then you're going to lay down, and you're going to take a nap, and you're going to be fine. Well, that's very much what life is like, and many of us are in like the seasick stage of life, and we've forgotten that land is probably a lot closer than we think. You can still hope. You don't have to give up. You don't have to worry. You can let go. Let go. You don't have to worry, and you can keep hope alive as you keep Christ before your eyes. Christ is the land for the seasick sailor. He's going to get you out of this. Man, I remember when I left the Crystal Cathedral as a college pastor, and that was my income, and I decided I wanted to plant my own church. I thought, if I plant my own church, I may lose everything. It took me my whole life, my wife and I up to that point, to save up like $40,000. And you know what? But when we planted our church, we lost everything. We lost every dollar. We had tons of student loans. And you know what? It wasn't that bad. Because we didn't lose anything more than everything. If that makes sense. You know, we this was the funniest thing, is right when we ran out of money, like when we hit zero from our savings, then we had a baby. And you know what? When we had $0 in our account, we were able to pay every bill and we just took care of things and everything was there that we needed. And everything was fine. And all that worrying I had about losing everything. I mean, I was right, but the worry was way worse than losing stuff. In fact, I look back at those times of my life and I cherish them and I remember them as some of the warmest, best times of my life. So don't worry. Keep hope alive. Don't quit. Don't give up. Trust in Jesus and keep him before your mind. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you and we trust you. And we decide today that we're not going to worry. We're not going to be afraid, that we can relax, just like Jesus relaxed. He did in the storm. He took a nap. Lord, we pray that we could be like that, that we would be people who would live in a different reality, the kingdom of God. Let it permeate every part of our life. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Joy.
Thank you for coming today. Thank you, everyone who's watching us around the world on Hour of Power. We love you, and we hope that today you are encouraged. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. And now for the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. As 2015 comes to a close, I want to say thank you to each and every one of you who regularly support this program. Your prayers and gifts have meant the world to us, and we just can't say thank you enough. This year, your generous support helped us expand this program into new television markets, reaching more people who need to hear the positive message of Jesus Christ. And as we move into 2016, we'll add even more outlets for people to hear about God's love for them. Now, as we close out the year, we're excited to offer you a deluxe Hour of Power edition of my newest book, Happiness According to Jesus. It's a book about how the Sermon on the Mount and the wisdom of Jesus is what brings us into the full, rich life that we all desperately want. I'm so passionate about this book that when you request your copy, I'll personally sign it for you. Or even taking it a step further, when you give us your request for this book, include a prayer request or like a specific moment when you felt happy or blessed, and your book will include a Bible verse selected just for you by the Hour of Power staff. You know, we receive letters, phone calls, and emails every day from people who are finding hope, rebuilding their families, or overcoming addiction or depression. Whether you're Janet from Denver or Mike from Sacramento, we want to hear from you. We want to pray for you, and we want to help you in your faith walk. Friends, thank you for supporting this program. Your gifts, prayers, and words of encouragement mean the world, and we couldn't do it without you. Thank you, and remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
As a thank you for your year-end support, we're pleased to offer a deluxe Hour of Power edition of Pastor Bobby's newest book, Happiness According to Jesus. We are offering the deluxe book for your tax-deductible donation of $60. This includes the book and a personally inscribed autograph by Pastor Bobby. So call, write, or go online and request your copy today. For your gift of $100, we'll not only send you Pastor Bobby's autographed book, Happiness According to Jesus, we'll also include a set of two beautifully designed porcelain mugs, each imprinted with an inspiring quote from the book. Do good. Bless others. And prayer is letting go. Your gifts help the Hour of Power stay on the air and make a positive difference to viewers around the world. We can't do it without you, so please write, call, or go online with your gift today.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And when you visit our website, you'll discover books, devotionals, and other resources to take your Christian life to a new level. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. And when you do, consider supporting this incredible ministry on a regular monthly basis. We're taking a life-changing message literally around the world. And your regular financial support makes all the difference. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.